Let's give Will about 2.5 more minutes and then we'll let him join after we get started.
I'm on, Lee.
Oh, good. Very good, Will. Thank
yeah,
you.
I was, yes, hello. I don't know. We were put on hold. I don't know what happened.
Well, we have to talk to the guy in charge here. This is just not unacceptable behavior. Well, we are all here. David, do you have Jerome nearby ready to go on board if we need him?
He is on the call. I think his audio is muted right now, but I see his name here, so he should be with us.
Okay. All right. Well, everyone is here, so what I'd like to do, it's 6:05. I'd like to call the September meeting of the City Planning Commission to order. My name is Lee Olson. I am the chair of the commission, and I am pleased to notify the public that we do have a quorum this evening. I have two items that I would like to interject into the agenda that are not there. Number one is that since Adam Thomas is no longer with the city, I was informed that David Paris, the administrator for the zoning bureau or zoning department, is our interim liaison between the city of Reading and the planning commission. So David and I have had some talks just to get prepared. And what I would like David to do is introduce the gentleman who the city has procured the services of an outside consultant since Adam has left to assist in the review of projects being submitted for planning commission approval, a gentleman by the name of Jerome. And what I would like is for David to introduce Jerome, and Jerome could be so kind as to give us a little bio, a brief bio of his talents and his experience, and then we'll get right to the agenda. So David, I will turn it over to you.
Thank you very much. So Jerome Skrinkowski, and he can correct me on the pronunciation, but is a member of the American Institute of Certified Planners and is a planning consultant. And I'd like to give him an opportunity just to introduce himself and say a few words. And I think we don't have audio for you, Jerome. Try this again. Try that again. Do you have any, do we have sound yet? It looks like you're connected to us twice to the meeting, and one of those connections is muted. If you can unmute the second connection, then that should get us the audio.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, great. I'm just going to turn off my other computer. Okay, we're here. I'm going to have to turn off the other computer. Hold on. Hey, sorry about that. We on?
Yep.
I don't hear you. Yes, you are.
Yep, we're good.
Thank you. My name is Jerome Skrinkowski. I'm the president and principal planner of Hawk Valley Associates. My bio, just quickly, is I have 35 years of professional planning experience. mostly in the private sector. However, I do have experience with the public sector as well. Most of my work has been engaged with planning, zoning, community development, and I'm happy to be aboard and help you out.
Well, Jerome, thank you very much. My name is Lee Olson. I am the chair of the Planning Commission. And when David told us that that the city had procured your services, we all breathed a sigh of relief because obviously running without a planner is a real detriment to us and our progress. And I'm glad that the city had the foresight to get somebody on board. So welcome. We certainly would like your input. We would hope that in part of your contracted services that you sit in on these meetings with us so that if any of the commission members have a question, you're right there at the ready to respond. So welcome. We're glad you're here and glad you're on board and working with David Paris. So thank you so much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay. Reading from the agenda, item number one is the acceptance of the September 2020 Planning Commission agenda. Do I have any questions or changes to the agenda? And if none, I'd accept a motion to accept the agenda as presented.
This is Wayne. I'll make a motion to accept the agenda as presented.
Okay, Wayne has made a motion to accept the agenda as presented. Is there a second?
Bob Coughlin will second.
Okay, Bob has seconded. All those in favor, please indicate by saying.
Mr. I would just add so we don't forget, so we have it for future, this is a template, of course, always the Blighted Property Review Committee report.
Okay. Thank you, because I have that with me.
Okay, good. So don't forget.
Okay, so we've added the Blighted Property Review Committee report by yours truly. Thank you. All right, with the minor adjustment, Wayne, will you accept that to the motion?
Yes, I will.
Okay, and Bob, you can second that accordingly.
I will second with that motion.
Okay, thank you. All those in favor of the motion with the addition of the Blighted Property Review Committee report, signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Opposed, the motion carries. Item number two, we have one subdivision / land development item on our agenda this evening. It is 810 Windsor Street, a final land development plan for adaptive reuse of existing three-story commercial building into 8 residential apartment units and 1 street level commercial unit. At this time, is there anyone representing the design team, the owner, or the developer of the project in the audience and on the Zoom meeting?
If I'm connected, I am. I'm Dan L.
All right, Dan L., welcome aboard. You have the floor. Would you be so kind as to tell us about the project? And what we'll do then is after you've finished, we will look to planning and zoning as well as Public Works for their input from staff. And then we will turn it over to the Planning Commission members themselves. So, Dan, you're on.
This is an existing structure that's been in the city for probably 100 years. I think it was formerly part of Jackson Rope, and then it became part of the outlet centers, and it has been, I guess, vacant for a number of years. The Jan and Will properties purchased it, and they have hired Miguel Herrera to create plans, creating 8 apartments and 1 small commercial space out of the area. It has existing water and sewer services. I think the reliability of those services need to be checked out. That hasn't been done unless Miguel's done it. It has the existing parking area. I had a lighting plan, I had it sent it out and had a lighting plan done, which is one of the when they got the zoning relief for the property, that's what the zoning wanted. They wanted the lighting plan. They wanted any issues that come up with land development. And so I tried to address the issues that were in the zoning decision. In talking to Tim Krall, what I wasn't aware of when I originally did my storm sewer is that they look at revisions to the roof line as new impervious, and I didn't account for any of that. So I did some calculations today, and it looks like we'd have about 1,153 square feet of new roof surface and new / impervious surfaces. I can do some landscaping beds, and with the 9 trees that are on the property, I think we can achieve the city's stormwater requirements with those issues for the minor increase in impervious area. We tried to minimize impact to the property, as trying to keep as much of the property the way it was. So decrease expense and decrease impact to the environment. So that's about all I have.
Okay, thank you, Dan. First, let's go to planning. I noticed that the request is for final land development, and I'm just kind of perplexed about the fact that this is the first time we are meeting you or seeing the project, and we're being asked to pass judgment on a final land development. That is not normally our course of action. So I'm going to ask Jerome and David if you could give us some insight as to, is this a final land development, or is it really a misnomer and is preliminary?
I'll start with that. And the submission is labeled as a final plan submission. And I believe that the review, my understanding is that it was based on that type of submission. And there are, as you've noted, some differences in the submission requirements for preliminary final and final plan submission. And Jerome, if you'd like to speak to that, but if you could confirm your review is based on this as a final, is that correct?
That is correct, David. The application itself was stated as a final plan, and all their correspondence reflected a final plan. What we could do for this particular project is combine both applications, call it a preliminary / final plan. That way it covers both aspects of a preliminary plan as well as a final plan.
And just to be clear, that would then require some changes to the submission to comply with the requirements for the preliminary as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Does that answer your question, Mr. Chairman?
Yes. David, do you have any drawings at your disposal that you can flip up on the screen? I would like to see what the site looks like. I did see some of the pictures in the handout, but I unfortunately did not bring that with me home this evening.
No, absolutely. Yeah. No, we'll put the drawings up on screen right now.
Okay.
In just a moment to get those up and then
sure.
View that. I'll put up the proposed conditions plan. I think that might be the most helpful, but we also have an existing conditions plan, a boundary plan, landscaping, as Mr.
Okay. Lowe
said, and
okay.
Lighting.
Okay. All right.
You should either see a picture of my kids or a plan right now, depending on which screen I'm sharing. Do you see the plan?
We see the plans. We don't
okay.
see kids.
Okay.
We don't see kids.
All right. And I can zoom in a little bit more to hopefully make that more visible for those of you who are looking on their computer screens. So as you can see, this is bounded on the one side by Windsor Street, on the other side by Douglas Street, and then there's an alley on either side of the property as well.
Oh, and I see the building, the three-story building, okay.
You know, if you can hear me, currently the property is completely impervious. It's completely paved and or the building is sitting on the balance of the property.
Okay. Okay. David, to your satisfaction, this project obviously went through zoning. And was it through zoning hearing, or were you able to give the zoning permit without having to go to hearing?
This did go through the zoning hearing board, and the zoning hearing board reviewed it. They did have a public hearing and issued a decision. The decision included some conditions which have largely been addressed at this stage, and those are actually noted on the plan. One of those is adding the photometric lighting plan, which was provided. Okay. Among some other items having to do with the parking, the parking site plan, but relief was granted that was requested to do this adaptive reuse project.
Okay, great.
That's probably why I just went to a final plan rather than, because the sketch plan was kind of moot at that point, and we had a shopping list of things that the zoning hearing board wanted us to do, so I went to, but I can make it of preliminary final if that's what the board wants.
Mm-hmm. Well, and listening to both Jerome and David, that's what they are presenting this evening. They are recommending that preliminary/final is their recommendation based on everything that you've done so far. David or Jerome, if you have nothing more, I'd like to go to Tim Krall from Public Works and get feedback from Tim and the Public Works review.
I have two additional comments, if I may.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, go ahead, sir.
And this is, we've circulated this for review, as is typical with the Fire Marshal's office as well as the City Arborist. We did receive some input from the City Arborist, which was passed along to Mr. Loudenslayer, and he's already made some adjustments to the landscaping plan. The plan that you have in your packet is the original submission, but we will recirculate the updated plans which we received.
Okay.
And then in addition, the comments from the Fire Marshal's office with respect to access, they did look at the width of the alleys, but based on the configuration and based on the fact that there is access from the front and rear, that is sufficient. They would just add that a Knox box would be required for the gates on both in the front and in the rear.
Okay.
So that would be accomplished through a note on the plan at this point.
Okay. All right. Tim Krall, would you be so kind as to weigh in from the Public Works viewpoint?
Sure. Yeah. First of all, Dave, Jerome Skrinkowski wrote a review letter, and I don't know, was that delivered to everyone? Did everybody get a chance to read Mr. Skrinkowski's review?
That was included in the packet that was provided to the Planning Commission, but not all members. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I saw it.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
As you might have seen, I reviewed it and then sent out a letter.
Right.
With review, and that there are things that are required as a preliminary plan that have to be added to this plan.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with that too, and I think Dan Loudenslayer also agreed with that too. Just to kind of, I guess, then piggyback on Jerome's letter, there is a few things that the Public Works Department is looking at for addressing here. One is, first of all, let me back up a little bit just so that everybody understands. What Mr. Loudenslayer is saying is that the site is 100% pervious, and it's that way now, and it will basically stay that way. So they're not proposing to do any new impervious except for the addition of the additional stories on the rear end of the building, which I believe he measured at 1150 square feet. So it's not a lot of area, but it does trigger stormwater management ordinance as a regulated activity. We see that as a new impervious area. However, since it's all impervious, it would not require water quantity control, It would, however, require water quality control, which we discussed on the phone. And I understand that Mr. Loudenslayer is saying is that now they're going to address that with respect to the water quality. And the water quality, of course, includes groundwater recharge and stream bank protection. So I agree with that and look forward to seeing that future submission. Couple other items we looked at from public works standpoint of view is the parking. The parking looks to be at least adequate. However, I didn't see anything with respect to ADA accommodations. Dave and I talked, and Dan, I'll direct this to you. Is there, maybe we can put a drawing up that might have, did you designate ADA spaces for the parking?
Yes, there's ADA spaces for the parking, and there's a ramp on the first floor that would go to what would be the commercial space, and the rest of it is serviced by stairs.
So where would the ramp be then?
It's in the middle of that existing building as you come in off of Windsor Street, off the alley. There's a ramp in there.
Okay. Oh, I get it. Yep. I think yep. David just circled it there.
It's kind of, it could be a little
very funny. Good. Okay. Yep. So that would be the accessibility. You're not looking at putting a ramp in the right of way then. You have a ramp already designated on the property.
That's existing.
Oh, it is. It's existing. Oh, yeah. I see. Oh, yeah. Very good. Yeah, I haven't had a chance to look at it. I do know that I think Wayne took pictures, and I hadn't had a chance to really go through the pictures, so I want to look at those and get a chance to look at this in the coming weeks.
The grade's pretty flat coming down from those parking spaces. I put them there so you'd have the 2% grade going down to that ramp to service it. So for an old site, it fits pretty nicely.
Okay. All right. Very good. The only other, because the parking is going to remain parking, so there's no new impervious there in the existing building other than the addition is existing building, so there's no impervious there. So other than that, the only thing we would look at would be the condition of the curbs and sidewalks that front on Windsor Street and Douglas Street. And from a brief look, again, from looking at photographs, it looks like the Windsor Street, your main entrance, is a little rough. So I think Mr. Skrinkowski and I are both saying this needs to be investigated a little more to see if we can't come up with a decision as to whether or not some of that or all of that would need to be rehabilitated. And that is really all that Public Works, the engineering part of Public Works, has comments on this plan. I take it back. One more item. And this is on Mr. Skrinkowski's letter too. And that's the Act 537, the sewer planning modules. And we discussed that too. I think you were going to do a comparison, Dan, on the water records.
That's what we've done in the past on these existing buildings, and I would imagine that the EDUs on when that was a manufacturing structure was probably a lot more than what the eight apartments are going to be.
It may have been, but we do need some record of that. We typically rely on RAWA or Reading Water Bureau records, depending on how far. If you go back to the 70s or 80s, if you can find those records to show that kind of usage exceeded the proposed usage, and show me that on a report, that then we can simply say that it's not within the scope of a planning module.
Yeah, that's what we've done in the past. I'll have to contact them and see what kind of records we can come up with.
Sounds good. Okay, that's all I have.
David, do we have any elevations, pictures of the existing building that you could put up on the screen so we may take a look? I thought, Tim, did you say that there was to be an addition put on the building?
Yeah, that's something we just kind of found out. I think it was submitted for the zoning. The architect prepared some, I guess you'd call them elevations. They kind of look like elevations, but it shows this addition.
Yeah, I'll put that up right now. I have that in the zoning application. Just one second.
Okay. Yeah, the first floor extends, there you are. The first floor extends all the way back, and then they're adding to the second and third floor to square the building off.
I got a better one here. This shows you. So here's existing. And then there's the proposed.
I see.
Shaded tan area is what's being added to the structure.
Yes.
And then
go ahead.
The roof area on that works out to about 1,150 square feet.
The basic exterior material is brick or block or plaster covered something?
Brick.
Okay. All right, I see. All right, good, thank you.
I think the building, the existing utilities in it, it was sprinkled and so they need to probably rehab that information, but the services are there that are most likely adequate for what they're planning to do.
Is the street level to be completely 100% commercial focused, and the upper floors are the 8 apartments?
No, there's 2 apartments on the first floor and a commercial section in the middle.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, on that one, you can see that top one, there's a small commercial area. I'm not sure what, I don't think they have any particular plans right now, maybe like a sandwich shop or something small like that.
Sure, understand.
And then an apartment on both sides, and then the upper floors each have 3 apartments.
Okay. Is there any proposed remediation or upgrading, cleaning of the facade of the building and doing anything to it that would impact its architecture?
I can't answer that question for you. I'll have to find that out. I don't know what they were planning on doing. I would imagine the Planning Commission would like it to remain the brick that it is.
Absolutely. I just was curious as to what the intent aesthetically was. I mean, all of the component pieces for occupancy are going to be reviewed by codes, buildings and codes, so that it complies with all the applicable building codes. But I was just wondering from an aesthetic standpoint, for the Planning Commission to see what your architect had in mind for any upgrades or any improvements to the building or any features added to it.
I think there's the outside. Is that painted brick or what? I can't tell from the picture. It's been a while since I looked at it.
Yeah, it looks like it's painted.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was wondering what the orientation is. I guess this is the north end, so you've got southern exposure, and was wondering if any window treatments were contemplated, such as awnings or solar screens or anything like that.
Well, I'd have to check with the architect on that. Windsor Street is that, and like you said, faces north. The one alley is on the east, and the other alley is on the west. And Douglas is on the south.
Yeah, got it. Okay. All right, if staff has no other comments, I'll turn it over to the members of the board if they would like to weigh in with opinions, comments of the presentation, and also the disposition of the preliminary final approval.
I guess I'll start.
Okay, Wayne.
Let's see here. I think we heard from David that that the fire marshal has reviewed the plan, so that the drop-off parking on the west side of the building is okay. I was a little concerned that since that's only a 10-foot wide alley, that parking might not be allowed there because in case of a fire, they would pull in the snorkel truck or one of the ladder trucks on that side of the building. But if fire marshal okays it, that's fine by me.
One of the zoning requirements were that the people own the daycare across the street, across Windsor Street. And one of the requirements was that we provide parking for the daycare. And that's why I put the drop off at the front there so that people could pull in there, drop off and take the children across the street.
Okay. You'll just need some signage for that. Because when I was there today, the people that were parked there permanently. Those can't be permanent parking spaces because of the possibility of fire trucks pulling in there. Which also relates to the parking lot. The parking lot, the spaces for the daycare across the street, and for the residents, they have to be marked on the plan, and they have to have signage because that's a commercial parking lot. They rent spaces, so therefore the spaces that are reserved for other reasons have to be marked so that people who are renting the spaces do not take them. It also will clear up a problem that we have at another site in this neighborhood where spaces have been double allotted. There are a few parking lots in this area where the developer has counted the spaces twice for three different projects. So in that case, there aren't enough spaces. So the spaces have to be marked and signed. On page one, there is a note there about parking for the daycare, but it sounds like the daycare center is going to be in this building and not in the building across the street. That has to be clearly defined where the daycare center is. If it's not
the daycare is across Windsor Street, so I can certainly clarify that, sir.
Yeah, on the note that needs to be clarified that the daycare is not in this building.
I think I wrote the note from the zoning ordinance just the way it was written, but we can clear that up.
Yeah, because if it was in this building, yeah, but since which also reminds me, you're going to have to submit. You're going to have to submit the parking space lease agreement with them across the street to the zoning hearing board and to us.
Well, it's the same owner.
Doesn't matter. If the building is sold. And the lease agreement continues under a different owner, that needs to be marked on the plan.
Okay.
Let's see here. The five commercial parking spaces in the lot need to be marked accordingly. I believe the landscaping plan was reviewed by the arborist.
Yes. And he didn't like the Norway maple, and I've changed that.
Yeah, that's a thing that we need to update in our ordinance, and we haven't been able to get around to it. So, you know, that's
But that's all right. That's
you did something wrong. We're a little bit behind the times.
That's typing. That we haven't planted the trees, so that's no problem. It's an ink right now.
And Dan, there's going to be nine trees planted.
Yeah, well, your letter said that on one page there was eight and the other page was seven. What happened? The one tree I removed on the lighting plan, on the one plan, because it was conflicting with the lights. So what I did is I moved a tree, 33 parking spaces to the north and the south of that light along the western driveway. And so now I have nine trees on the site. Okay. And then it's not conflicting with that pole lamp there along the western alley.
Okay.
And as we mentioned, since this is a preliminary final, everything that's on the preliminary plan has to be included on this plan, which includes the drawing out and how do you put this? Might have to ask Tim for some help here. But all the adjoining properties, their owners, and their deeds have to be marked on the plan. Since it's a significant number of, properties, you would have to ask Public Works if they would grant a waiver to that part of the ordinance. And I
think we could actually put those on. It doesn't take that long to take all that information off the tax maps, rather than ask for the waiver. It's just at till people look at it the first time, it was a lot of effort to put into it. So I can put the adjoiner names.
Okay, because that's you know, pretty much standard for all our land development plans. And I think it is helpful to you know, to anyone who does look at it, especially since there's a mix of residential and commercial properties adjoining this plat. And I believe that's everything for me.
Hey, anything else, Wayne?
No, I think that's everything. There was one other minor thing, but I know what it was. It was about the fire escapes. But that's a moot point since they're putting an addition to the building, and the addition of the stairwell at the back of the building would meet all the fire code requirements. Therefore, they wouldn't have to add a new fire escape or anything to allow for exit from the third floor as it now exists. So that's a moot point.
There is one point. There are a number of gates along the eastern alley, and I think they were originally when the outlet had it, and they would come from across 9th Street through those gates. And I would imagine those gates are going to be discontinued, that they'll be locked, and they're not anticipating any access through those gates along that alley. And the one on Douglas Street would be restricted. They for security, they just want people entering Windsor Street. And if we put the Knox box on there, then that would allow the fire company to be able to get access to the site at any time.
Okay, that's everything. That's everything I have.
Okay, any other comments from any of the other Planning Commission members?
And Mr. Chairman, this as well, I have a few.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, well, first of all, I thought the same thing, that the daycare was in this facility too. So that'd be good that it'd be clarified. Just for the benefit of the public, the Norway maple is considered an invasive species. So that's why we are not permitting it, even though it's on the city's list of approved species. I reviewed the plans, but I can't see the video. So am I understanding that I saw there was the proposed expansion to the building, the loading zone area. Am I understanding the 1150 square feet is over the course of multiple stories? In other words, the footprint is less than 1150 square feet for the proposed expansion. Is that right?
The ground floor footprint of the building is all that you'll ever have. As the building went up, the second floor tapered back and the third floor was shorter. And they're going to extend that the third floor out 1150 feet and extend it down to the first floor and make the stairwell in there. So
the first floor is the footprint, and whatever it may be below that. I see. Okay, now I understand.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So that's why it's not exceeding the 800 square foot threshold for us for the plan, why we're only reviewing this as the parking lot plan. Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense. And sometimes, Mr. Chairman, we do go straight to final as something simple, but things are never as simple. So there's always some, especially with the stormwater management and things, but we're progressing a lot. Just a brief comment is that I'm familiar with the building. This area of the city was a heavy industrial area. It was before there was a zoning law, and so there are factories in close proximity to houses. And in the 1970s, it was repurposed for the outlets. This was one of the buildings in the main complex. And with the demise of the outlets, it has the area has seen a lot of adaptive reuse. So that fits in with that, things that are serving the needs of the people. So I thought there was a daycare already. So now it makes more sense that the first floor here would be proposed for some other kind of a business. So, and like I say, with houses close by, amidst the commercial, this makes sense. And the only question I have, because most of the issues were zoning matters, is with the parking lot, we normally have a subdivision land development requirement for some kind of a screen for headlights, because these would be the beams would be going into people's kitchens and upstairs bedrooms perhaps, so depending on the grade, do we have that requirement? Even I mean, obviously it would be, I'm sure, for Little Cedar Street, but even on the other side where the alley is, or is it only for the, I don't know if the someone could advise, is it only for the fronts of buildings, or would it be also for the rear? I don't know what kind of fencing it is, if it's just a wire from what we could see from the pictures that our colleague provided. Does our clinic consultant have anything on that could clarify?
The fence is chain link. And as far as the screening, the way I read the ordinance, you don't put the screening along an alley. Handle some of the stormwater, I can put bushes and screening along the eastern alley. And that would take care of that requirement.
Yeah, because because the eastern alley is, I'm presuming by the fact that it's named Little Cedar Street as a public street, and whereas the other one on the western side is a private alley. I'm presuming if I'm correct, if not, someone would correct. So I would think it would apply then, but I'm looking to our consultant for clarification on that.
Yes, I think that this would be something that we would have to work with the developer on. It's not necessarily a street per se, and it's not necessarily frontage or a rear that we're trying to protect. But I mean, I think that what Dan had suggested would work. And I think we should, work in or attempt to work with him on that.
Jerome? Yeah, so like I said, we couldn't see the rear of the park. Like, we don't know if all the residents have, you know, their own fencing or screening to begin with. But so, yeah, something that you'll have to look into further. And that's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Jerome, Mr. Chairman, if I could just add on. Jerome, if you want to call me and let's look at the city's official topographic plan, and we can determine whether or not Mr. Simfici's question about Little Cedar Street is an alley or a street. I'm thinking it may be an alley. There are alleys in the city that have names like Little Caesar that may actually be really alleys and not street. And then some things that look like alleys that have names actually are streets. So I have to go to the official plan, and we will be able to determine that and let Mr. Loudenslayer know what the designation is.
Yeah, I was thinking it's an alley because I don't think it shows up on the topographic plans. It shows up as when you read the deeds and you lay the deeds out, it goes to an alley. And all the deeds go along an alley, and it calls it an alley. But
yeah, but that's what I was thinking too.
Yes, also, but what's confusing is we have public streets that are called alley too. So it needs to be looked at. So thank you, Mr. Crawl. That's the right approach. Yep.
Tim, on the Berks County tax maps, it did not. You could not click on either of those to determine who owned that portion of the. Of those alleys or roads. So it certainly was not a dedicated area.
Mm-hmm. Right. So it's correct as indicated on the drawing.
Yeah, so far, unless the there's other information that
we'll verify. It's always best to verify with the official topographic plan at Public Works.
Are there any more comments by any other members of the Planning Commission board or any other staff comments?
Just one thing I wanted to add is my review came out today, and I think most of the comments that we discussed on this project are in here. Just wanted to check with the applicant as well as the Planning Commission to see if there were any issues that need clarification. I'd be happy to provide that. But I think it's pretty well straightforward for the applicant to follow in order to secure municipal approval.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Jerome, very much. Okay. If there's no other comments, I would entertain at this time a motion to approve a preliminary / final land development plan with recommendations of 810 Windsor Street.
We actually can't move on this project because there are a number of outstanding permits that must be received before we can make a motion on this. We'll have to table this plan. The big one, of course, is that we don't have the sewer modules.
Tim, what's your opinion of the timetable for receiving a sewer module approval?
Well, first, they got to determine whether or not a sewer module is applicable for this lot. As Mr. Loudenslayer stated, it could very well be that the prior use would exceed the use, meaning the flow for that use may exceed what the proposed use is. And so when he does the calculations, we'll be able to make that. If it turns out that it's not and modules are required, that typically can take 2 months, maybe longer to get it through because it needs a resolution from City Council and a review by our consultant to make sure that capacity is going to be adequate. It could take 2 months or longer.
Okay. All right, then I will withdraw my consideration of a preliminary slash final. And based on what Wayne and Tim have presented to us, I'll ask that we table action on 810 Windsor Street, predicated on the recommendations of our consultant for planning, and then also the lack of the appropriate permits that give us the green light to go ahead and issue a final land development approval. May I have a motion, please?
This is Wayne. I'll make a motion to table the plan for 810 Windsor Street.
Okay. Motion's been made by Wayne to table action on 810 Windsor Street. Is there a second?
A second.
Second by Will. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of tabling the motion, please indicate by saying aye.
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 Opposed? It has been agreed upon among the Planning Commission members to table action on 810 Windsor Street. Okay. Next item is Commission Liaison Report. Wayne?
Tim and I had a email discussion earlier this month about the sewer modules and what type of permits are required to before final approval will be given. So Tim gave me some research to do with the help of our friends in Kumru Township. So I'm going to review that and then add that to our list of changes we would like to make to the SALVA.
Okay. All right, there's a bullet point here, Wayne. Proposed SALDO revision status update.
That's the status update on that. Next month I should have the proposed wording for that and a few other things. And then Tim suggests that we once the timing is right and Jamal and David and whoever's at the table sit down, we might have to write out an RFP to actually do a complete rewrite of the SALDO. So that is something that we'll also need to discuss.
Okay. All right. Anything else under your liaison report, Wayne, that you want to bring up at this time?
No, that was the only thing that I was able to work on this month.
Okay.
I just have a question, Mr. Chen, on the, if I may ask Public Works, how is the sewer module, how is that calculated? Is it from the original use or the last approved use, the differential from that point? We're talking about a building here that's going through multiple uses, with the applicant the plan we just reviewed. So that's why I'm wondering.
Yeah, that's something I wondered about too. And I actually went right to DEP and got it in writing from them. And the way they determine that, because they know that there's a lot of reuse and adaptive reuse of buildings and re-subdivisions, what they look at is 1972, and there's a date, May something in 1972. That was the date that the Act 537 plan, Act 37, actually took effect. And so from that date, that's the date they look at what was established on the property at that date. If there was a use that was there and it had a certain flow gallons per day. They assumed that would be the flow that was established at that time, and that's what they use as a benchmark. So they look back at that that use, and you compare your proposed use to that, and they actually allow you to exceed up to 1 gallon per day less than one EDU in addition to what was there. So you can add almost another EDU to what was there in 1972 and not need to do planning modules. But if it's two EDUs over, you need to do planning modules. Or if it's even actually a little over, if it's just over one EDU more, then you need to do planning modules. And I have that all written down. So if anybody wants to see that, I can send that to them.
Thank you. That was helpful. Now, of course, I'm curious. Well, what if at that particular date it was a vacant property? And counting that as zero, would make it, that would make it challenging for anybody proposing a reuse. It could be two or three uses later. Yeah.
Right. And if you can't come up with any documents that verify that, then you have to assume it was vacant or there was no flow, and then start from what you've got. You're gonna apply then for what you're proposing. And if I may, I'll comment on Wayne's comment there. Just to elaborate a little bit on what he was saying. In the current saldo, there is nothing in there that requires an applicant to provide most of the permits that we are requiring them to supply, which should be the case. And as he mentioned, in Kumru, they do that, but the city doesn't. Most municipalities do. I think now that we have Jerome on board, Wayne, that would be your contact. This was prior to Jerome coming on board, and I think he would be your best resource now. You don't have to go to Kumru, or you could still go to Kumru, but use him as a resource and have him look at the saldo and see if he doesn't agree with that. And he may have a lot of other ideas too, but there are, it's old. It's time for an upgrade on the saldo. That's my 2 cents worth.
All right, good deal. Okay, other business, what I'd like to report on, thanks to Will, is last Thursday was a Blighted Property Review Committee meeting that was held in City Hall. It was a combination determination and certification hearing. There were 17 properties that were brought before the BPRC. Two were certified as being blighted. There was a consent agenda where 12 were determined to be blighted. Two properties were tabled to May of 21 to the certification hearing, and one was removed from the list itself. So that's that report. I unfortunately was on vacation, so I didn't have to appear. So Ms. Kelleher, city clerk, sent me the report, and I just wanted to put that into the meeting minutes. The last item of other business is pending/future cases. Status update, David and or Jerome, do you have any insight as to what's coming down the pike?
As far as what already before you, just a very brief update on that. Last month, the Skate Park Association was before you, as well as a land development project for Greg Avenue. I just wanted to let you know we had not received any updated submissions, which is why they're not before you this month. There is, and I'll ask Tim if he can speak to this, but there is a brief update on the Gateway West project. We are in the short answer on that is we're awaiting the NPDES, but Tim, if you want to just, I know you've been in touch with Ludgate Engineering.
Yeah. As you remember, there was a few items on my comment list from last month's meeting, and they have updated all of their drawings to indicate the responses to those comments. And it appears that they've addressed all of my comments that I've made, except for the NPDES permit, which is a significant one. In fact, it's probably the most significant of all the comments, because the city's stormwater management ordinance rides on the DEP's approval of their post-construction stormwater management. And that's due to the fact that we can't infiltrate on this site. So it's doubly important now that we have a NPDES permit, which by the way, is not included in the SALDO. Nobody's listening.
All the more reason.
All the more reason to do it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think we should take advantage of Jerome's contractual obligations and see if we can slip this in.
More lessons.
Okay. Anything else, David?
Not from us. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Is there anything else for the good of the order this evening, gentlemen?
Just a quick question on Buttonwood West. Do we need to ask them for an extension?
Wait, I'll get back to you on that and let you know where we are. My understanding is that that we're still okay on timing, but I will confirm that and let you know.
Yeah, I haven't been keeping track of it. Yeah. So Adam was doing all of that.
Yes, and he has an extensive log of all these. So yeah, we're going through that right now.
Okay, great.
Yeah, that Mr. Chair, that would be helpful if we had a tracker for the commission too to keep up with, because it's very difficult to keep track of the status of all of these.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to speak over you, but we do have a tracker. Okay. We could certainly share, provide you with an update on that as part of the report. I can see that would be.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. Anything else for the good of the order? David clarified for me that we do have for the year of 2020 our monthly meeting, which is the fourth Tuesday of the month. I was thinking I got off scot-free today, but that didn't happen. So mark your calendar for the fourth Tuesday of October. We will meet again. So hearing no more business to be brought before the Planning Commission, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make the motion.
Motion made by Ermetti Raffaelli. We are adjourned. Gentlemen, thank you all very much.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.
This is the court reporter. Can I just get Mr. Paris, sorry, I have very bad names. Email, just so I can email him for any names or whatnot.
Sure. Yeah, I'll send it to you here in the chat.
Thank you.
All right. Jerome, thank you so much. A pleasure meeting you. Looking forward to working with you.
It was a pleasure. Thank you.
Good. You bet. David, good job. Number one meeting. Way to go.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
All right.